I've been thinking, we're really talking here today about a fundamental shift in how we're thinking about education and how we're thinking about the relationship between education and jobs and meaningful work experiences, especially as we heard from the last panel. Because we're in a world that it's so obvious, but I don't think we think about it enough. We are in a world that is constantly changing, and it's changing faster all the time. And so we've been hearing this morning about effective programs and the role that community colleges can play in local economies, in local communities, connecting people to jobs. What I'm excited that we now turn to this panel is to really think about the design and what kinds of data and information can help us design those programs that serve local economies, serve local employers, and serve local residents and community members and families. So to start, before I turn it over to the panel, I will just share a little bit about JPMorgan Chase. I'm Liza Cowan. I lead our South Region Global Philanthropy team for JPMorgan Chase. And many of you are aware of our work, but for those who aren't, I'll just say that what is it that we're doing in this space? As I've worked for the firm, I've learned that a lot of bankers are like psychologists, and they are hearing, my colleagues hear from their clients every single day, businesses big and small, their hopes, their dreams, their visions, their wants for the future of their companies, their families, their individual desires. And one of the things that we've heard all around the world in the communities where we work is this need for a skilled workforce and the number of employers who are not able to find the workers that they need to grow their companies in the way that they want to grow their companies. And so at the end of 2013, we launched an initiative that we call New Skills at Work. It's a five-year, $250 million global initiative really focused on closing that skills gap. And I can't remember who, I think Davis, you said, stop talking about middle skill jobs, but we do talk about middle skill jobs. But because we were hearing from the employers that it wasn't the bachelor's degree holders that they were looking for, and it wasn't just those with high school graduates, but they need workers who meet other needs and have a different set of skills. And so we developed a grant-making initiative, and we really come at this from three different directions. One is we have to have the data. We're funding programs and studies looking at the data about what the local economy needs, about what the local employers need, about what those career pathways are, what credentials are needed to meet. But we know that to design the programs, and again, we'll hear from the panel more about this, to design the programs, we have to understand that data. We have to have access to that data. Secondly, we need strong intermediaries who are pulling employers to the table to then inform the training providers, who are also coming to the table, about what the local employers are looking for. And we had some questions before about soft skills. That's part of it as well. We have to understand that from a training provider perspective, that if we do these things, the employers will hire our graduates. And then the third element of our initiative is to invest in those best training providers and those who are really proving that their graduates, that they're preparing those graduates for the work in local economies. So again, I am really thrilled to be able to moderate this discussion now with this panel. And you have their bios, so I won't introduce them, but I will ask each of them to spend about 10 minutes giving an overview of what they've learned about program design and what their perspective. So I will start with Penny Inroth from the Palmer Foundation.
I have a PowerPoint too. I want to say that unlike the other two gentlemen, we have the large city of Miami, the medium city of Rochester, and we really are a rural county. And 8 years ago, we didn't have a STEM culture. It didn't exist. I'm from Wisconsin originally. We funded, as the Palmer Foundation funded, about five middle schools for the training and Project Lead the Way. I tried to come down to, you know, retired down to the South with my husband and in North Carolina. They do have Project Lead the Way in the Research Triangle, but it wasn't going to happen in Moore County. I tried for 3.5 years to get it into the public schools. Tremendous pushback. They had the cutbacks and staff, you know, was suddenly gone, and they were, we had teachers and administrators that were concerned. We're scared. It wasn't going to happen in their school. So I went to the outreach person and the job development dean from the community college. Remember, we're a rural county, and this is one point I'd make to fundraisers. If you want to get a STEM culture rapidly in a rural county, look to the community colleges. They have the trained people in advanced math, science, technology, et cetera, okay, and engineering. And that's what we did, and we trained, instead of middle school teachers, we trained two PhD professors who went up and took the training at Duke, and then integrated it with the college curriculum, and we funded computer-assisted design, pre-engineering, and biomed. The high school kids, this was the start of the pathway system. The high school kids came to the college. The kids were ready for this. The teachers weren't, but the kids were ready. About 250 are now attending classes, both curriculum classes and certificate classes at the community college. And I have a PowerPoint from our, yeah, that's right, I have that too. I think, if you don't mind, I think I'll stand up so I can see the PowerPoint. All right, the community college that I'm involved with in the South is Sand Hills Community College. And we funded the renovation of of the old maintenance building as a facility to have the trade center. Okay, it has the big doors, they were able to get equipment in, et cetera. So we came forward and said we'd pay for half of the renovation of the building. And that was in 2013, and that meant insulation, bathrooms, added a classroom, etc. Then during that year, and this is an important point for funders, you can get the money for equipment from the state and the Fed, but you can't get money for buildings. So come forward if your community college needs a building, renovate a building, build a building. In one of our campuses, we also have modular units for trades. But you got to have the place to put it, or you can't get the equipment. Once you get the equipment at the building, the equipment comes. Classes started in January of 2014, and this is their thing. We only did things that the local companies wanted. Okay, so we weren't changing everything. Back one. Guess who has never done this before? Okay, our Hope campus, which is about a half hour away from the main campus, is in Hope County, and it has a five-year high school already, and the kids take college courses and also certification courses, and at Hope, you have the Certified Production Technician Program. And that has been very successful, and particularly with Unilever, which is in that same town. And they've hired, 9 or 10 of the graduates, and they said they could put them right on the line. They know everything that they're doing. Last month, they've agreed, signed a contract with Sand Hills Community College. We're going to train their entire production staff in certified production technology. The equipment for this came from the Golden Leaf Foundation, and that is a North Carolina foundation funded by the litigation money for the tobacco industry. their main goal is retraining, because you have all the displaced people that, you know, were growing tobacco, or the textile people. And this is in a modular unit, but it's still extremely effective, and you can see now it's already gone to scale. Cody Industries may also have a contract with us in the near future, as well as Butterball, the turkeys or whatever. Well, it's a big industry though. And the reason they like it is that it improves safety, and the students are trained in how to maintain the equipment, et cetera. Okay, I must hold on too long, I'm sorry. That's the full program. Victor Technology gave us 6 welding machines and also a plasma cutter. And so we had the 6 welding machines and started for welding 1, 2, and 3. And the kids come during the day, the high school kids come during the day, and adults at night. I think these are adults also. We have apprenticeship programs in electrical apprenticeship 1 through 4. By the time you get to 4, you're getting into programmable logic. And if it would be a modern factory, they'd have panels on the wall, and these students would know how to troubleshoot and program something that needed to be reprogrammed in the line of production. Here they're basic electric apprenticeship trainers. And these are national certifications, as you can see at the bottom. When you've completed 4, you have 1 more year of experience, and then you're a journeyman electrician. And there's another thing that hasn't been said. Only 7% of the U.S. population belongs to unions today. We are the new apprenticeship program. That means only 7% have access to apprenticeship programs through unions. We are the new apprenticeship program, and that's another reason why this suddenly has become so important nationally. Okay, people that have helped us. I mentioned Golden Leaf. They did the certified production equipment. We funded the restoration of and this is the building. Not elegant, but it works. but also we gave the cash grant. Well, here's Victor's with what they gave for the welding. Unilever and some of the graduates, and as I just said, they just signed a contract to train the entire production staff. Duke Energy has been particularly helpful for us too. They gave us a virtual welder. Now that saves you on energy, on metal, and also safety factors when you're just learning how to become a welder. And then below is a programmable logic trainers in automated technology. And they gave us 2 of those. Then just last month, they gave us $250,000 in portable electronics training programs and programmable logic controls. Then we gave a cash grant, our foundation did, because it required a cash grant to get it, a Golden Leaf grant to build another building, 4,800 square feet. And in addition to our cash grant, they had the gifts in kind of Duke Energy. So that has just come up. and occupancy permit last week. The equipment is being put in. And in fact, we were worried with the one is coming from overseas, it's waiting. We couldn't put it in the building until we got the occupancy permit. We didn't want it to be sent back to Asia or wherever it came from. Anyway, those programs in CNC machining will start in September. And let me see, there was another company. Ingersoll Rand is going to lay out the line of production with the machines and program the CNC machines for us. So again, there's industry involvement all the way through this. Placement of students, the higher rate is 73% get the job within a year. Also, among all the community colleges within the state of North Carolina, and there are 100 counties, 58 community colleges in North Carolina. Anyway, Sand Hills just got an award in January for the highest increase in wages with 2 years of education at the community college, 41%. Well, this talks about the CNC machining, and robotics will come after that. So that's basically what we're doing right now. Now, on your table, you have some paper that you might want to look at. There's the brochure from the Snap-on, but that is their educational wing. They have 49 certification programs. Chrysler Fiat has some 35. Train in HUVAC has 2. Now, what the difference with these programs are, the national companies are requesting or asking for extra training of their technicians that they're hiring. So they have, training is continuing, is exactly the same across the United States. So there are about 289 community colleges that are involved in this program. And there's another little white and blue brochure on each of your tables, and that's, you might want to Google that to see about CNC machining. I mean, they're all the C's. NC3, and NC3 is a National Certification Coalition of certification centers. So the C3 stands for the Coalition of Certification Centers. What the national companies are saying, besides wanting standardization, that technicians today also have to have in-service. Oops, sorry.
we will come back as we have discussion. Thank you so much, Penny, for that overview. And I want to... I want to turn now to Todd, because you've just spoken, Penny, about some very important infrastructure, sort of hard infrastructure investments. Todd has developed some tools, especially using, or Todd and his colleagues, really looking at labor market data and other technology tools. So I'll call those infrastructure investments of another kind, and we'd love to hear from you.
Sure.
That.
So. A lot of the work in terms of design that has shaped some of the interventions we've been doing over the last 3 or 4 years in the Rochester region has really centered around using a data model and trying to really get beyond preparing people for good paying jobs and the whole middle skill dynamic of having lots of national reports and maybe state level reports. But as a practitioner and a team of practitioners working in a transitional economy, trying to understand much more deeply what does that really mean for us, and trying to move away from some of these larger trends to very local trends. And so one of the things that we've done to try to achieve that is to try to create a regional model that basically quantifies and monetizes the gaps that are in our region around middle skill specifically, but by that I mean less than a bachelor's degree, more than a high school diploma, primarily around technician-based positions. And the slide that we've put up there, that's just a graphic that comes from a National Governors Association report that I really like, because I think it does a really nice job of trying to illustrate what we're trying to achieve within our region. And predominantly what we're trying to do, if you look at the top, the little circle there is actually referencing a convening process. We believe the data model for a region can be a convener between two main poles, and that's between the career pathway. We hear a lot about career pathways. We want to embrace career pathways as a system that needs to cross the secondary and post-secondary worlds so that we can have alignment of curricula. And those, we believe, should be guided by where we have documented need. And some of that documented need is more than just demand, because you have lots of high-demand, low-skill positions, and we're trying to stay away from those and really try to have quality of pathways. And we have a fairly rigorous process by which we qualify for that. And I'll talk about that in a second. But the other piece of that on the other side of the screen is the sector strategy for the region. So we want to be relevant as a community college. It's how are we relevant if there is a gap, let's say, in manufacturing, and our region is predominantly advanced manufacturing, healthcare, where the sixth largest employer in New York State is actually the University of Rochester's medical system, so about just under 20,000 people are employed, so that's obviously a big focus, and then also information technology. And what we want to be able to do is to take what's traditionally an educational model, which is career pathways, right? It comes out of a lot of areas of education, adult basic education, looking at student engagement and things like this. And on the other side, we have traditional sector strategy, which we all hear about in terms of knowing what the areas are we're trying to grow in our region. And so we believe the data model is a way for us, at least at the community college labor market level, to convene that. And so what we've done, if we could go to the next slide, has essentially produced a year ago just under a 200-page mapping of the skill gaps across 23 occupational groups. And what that basically is a supply and demand analysis. We wanted to look at the formal education system within our region, ability to produce the worker, and then look at what the demand for those occupations are and try to see if we can approximate the size of the so-called gap. And that's basically what we did, and we again applied it to 23 is why it's such a large report. It's just repeating that framework. And so this is one of the frames that is probably the most useful for design for us, is this is what we call the dashboard. And it's essentially looking at tooling machining producers within our region. MCC is one of the largest because of we have the largest base of technical programs. But we also have a couple of our other community colleges as well as our skill centers. And those of you who are not familiar with New York, we have a really robust system of what I call skill centers in the secondary world. And they produce technical workers at a lower level of skill set, but certainly at a level that we would consider measuring. And so that's essentially what we're doing. On the left, we measured what an annual output would be using IPEDS data, as well as for the non-credit programs. We survey our institutions so we can compile, if you will, the production value. And then on the right, we looked at the demand. And when we measured demand, we did not look at a linear relationship. We look at the transferable skill sets of those students coming out of these programs where they could be hired in the economy. And then we treat those as a group, one of 23 groups, and then we conduct a wage curve, and we start to analyze in the region what are people making at the 10th, 50th, and 90th percentile, and how does that relate to self-sufficiency standards? Because one of the things that's a big concern for us when we're looking at pathways is that we understand where on a given curve are they going to be self-sufficient if they're a single mother with two children, if they are two adults working and they have two children. We want to have a sense of where that lies for the county that we're in. And so anyway, as long story kind of short, we've done that work. And what's come out of that in terms of impacting design is that what it showed us is that our ability to impact the gap, because they are so large, is challenging when you have high attrition rate, because that's essentially the way we're thinking of it is a production system. And that off-puts some folks when you start talking about education and creating a worker, like you're creating a product. But it has uses when you take that perspective, because you start to understand attrition as basically inefficient throughput. And so one of the things that we began doing is thinking, how could we, given there's such a gap, how are we going to make consistently more workers at a post-secondary level? And what we ended up coming to is what a lot of folks here have talked about today is acceleration. So what we arrived at is a model where we're taking the certificates, the academic certificates that are part of an Associate of Applied Science program, so that's 30 to 31 credits of curricula. It's a sizable amount of curricula. It's basically the technical core of the associate's degree, because the second year is going to have gen ed, and it's going to have some other technical courses, but primarily more gen ed than technical. So what we found is when we look at our graduates coming from our associate's program, or our programs in general, about 50% or more are coming from the certificate programs, and they're stopping there and getting employed. What we've also found out is that there's not a strong wage premium for those certificate holders to go to an associate's, meaning that the gap is big enough that the employer will accept somebody with a certificate, and they don't pay a premium for if they go to the next step. So we don't see a lot of uptake necessarily on that. Now, whether that's good or bad, I mean, we could argue we want to have, obviously, our students move forward. But that's the reality of the labor market. And what that reality allows us to do then is to focus on the certificates. So what we did four cohorts ago is we took our 31 credits of our tooling machining curriculum, and we accelerated into 22 weeks, and we adopted a cohort-based learning model where essentially we group the students together, we recruit them together, they go through the program together. We have a faculty cohort model where we have a dedicated full-time faculty and two adjuncts that teach the entire curriculum. And We do that because as the students come in, they're obviously assessed for readiness. If they have to be within a certain level of being ready because we have no time to remediate. As long as they're within the acceptable level, then we track the students, and we know as the students move from class to class, they're with each other, and the faculty know where students' weaknesses are. So we have those embedded supports, and that makes a big difference. And what we end up with is a program taking one curricula taught in a traditional way, the same curricula taught in an accelerated way, using a cohort-based model. You have a difference of a 33% completion rate within 3 years using the Department of Education regulations or their 150% of term measurement, to in 22 weeks, that same curriculum, we can get 80 to 85% completion rate with active job placement at around 90 to 95%. So we actively created a worker at a post-secondary level. They have this is not non-credit, this is credit-based. They're placed into a job, and then ultimately, hopefully, what we want to see is them to come back to the institution if they access their tuition reimbursement, and they're able to then move on, if they want to, up into a technical degree at a four-year level or more. We have a very large educational cluster within Rochester, so somebody can go from a technician level program for optics and go up to the PhD level if you wanted to, without moving and leaving the community. So that's been a big piece of us, and so what we're trying to do now, we've done four of those, we're starting a fifth one. We've since, with a very generous, I'm pleased to say, gift from the JPMorgan Chase Foundation and New Schools at Work, we're a part of that in New York State, are now creating an accelerated, what we call Middle Skills Bridge Program, which is essentially trying to replicate for those students who are not quite ready in terms of readiness, so we can't let them into that program, but that's the experience they want. We will then give them an experience that will try to get them math ready. A lot of the deficiencies for students in these technical programs is quantitative literacy. And so now we've just piloted one in the fall. We're now running our first full cohort, which will be 15 students, and we're beginning to run those actually in the community. And if we could go two slides forward. One more, please. So what we end up with is what our model, and this is our community-based learning model, which is essentially, or cohort-based learning model, excuse me, which is showing that as we recruit students from the neighborhoods, we have a lot of urban poverty in Rochester. We're trying to recruit, which is predominantly more and more a non-traditional audience, generational poverty that goes back several generations. How do we get students from that background, regardless of their age, into these programs? And so one of the ways that we're doing that is to try to partner with agencies that are part of that community already and using their support services to provide to the student instead of the college trying to replicate it. And so the goal is with this Middle Skills Bridge Program, as we've been deploying it, is we deploy them in the community at agencies. So we're doing it at the Veterans Outreach Center. We'll be doing it soon at the Ibero-American Action Lead, which is Hispanic-focused, and they have the great credibility there with that community, and then also looking at things like the Urban League. And then the goal is in the future is to have these deployed, so we're creating a bigger pool of ready students that want to have the accelerated option. And by doing that, we'll ultimately, hopefully, be able to more than double the output against the gap that we measured in that previous slide. And so as we kind of come to kind of wrap that up, the point of that is around the model, this book that we produced that has these 23 gaps, we've convened, it's been very useful for us as a school to guide our programming, but it's also something we want to share with our community because we want to try to reduce the duplication of effort. Between the many well-intentioned agencies that are trying to focus on workforce. And so what the feeling is, if we can get everybody to agree that this model around these occupations represents reality, as close as we can measure it, then what do we do about it? If these are the producers that create workers in manufacturing, and these are the worker or the producers in education system that produces the workers for optical systems tech or healthcare workers, then if we know there's a large gap, then how of each of our capabilities are we able to work together to produce more numbers and recruit from where we need to, disadvantaged audiences where we can economically or educationally upskill them and get them into a pathway that leads to a truly a family wage job and break some of that generational poverty. So we're trying to take a systematic approach. I'll kind of wrap it up with the thing that I'm really excited about is a part of the investment by JPMorgan Chase Foundation, we also got some funding that they agreed to do to take the book that is a big electronic book and convert it into a database website for our region. And so we're just ready to launch that in August. We're populating it now with a new, fresh data. We're tying in through an API format directly into the sources of that data. So now it's an evergreen product. And our community, all the workforce developers that we've created a group that is going to use this and they advise us in building it, will be able to access the same perspective on on the issue, and through that then start to have a actual dual enrollment sequences, as you can imagine, and various types of interventions that go across the institutions and the 10-county region that we're doing this for. So
Todd, thank you so much for that robust overview. And I think before we turn to questions, I'd like to ask President Padron to talk about how this all happens in action. You lead the largest community college in the country in an economy in South Florida that's certainly rapidly changing as we talk about needing to respond to the needs of local communities and local residents. And so would love to hear how you and your team are thinking about this.
Thank you. First of all, thank you to the organizers for giving me the microphone with an accent. it's wonderful. You know, after listening to my two co-presenters, there should be no question that community colleges are the answer to the emerging innovation economy of the 21st century. And frankly, this is the community colleges, as we all know, are the only true invention in education in America, because the rest are copies of the British and German systems. And the community college is really the institutions that are really liberalizing education. If you believe the statistics have been thrown out in the last 5 years or so about almost 2/3 of all the new jobs being created in America today require post-secondary education. That means that most Americans without some college post-secondary credential cannot aspire to achieve the American dream or to ever be part of the middle class. So there is a big burden for us. You know, we believe that, yes, we need to think globally, but we need to act locally. And acting locally to me means that the word that I always use is collaboration. We cannot do it alone. We have to collaborate with government, we have to collaborate with business, we have to collaborate with the school system, because after all, most of the students that we get come from the local schools. And that collaboration is key, because without that collaboration, we cannot get anything done. And most of the programs that we're creating to react to the needs of the new economy are a direct result from that collaboration. I've been in this business for a long, long time, and I remember the times when businesses were giving a lot of lip service to education. But something has happened, something has changed, which I think is wonderful. And I think is the result of the tremendous need that businesses are finding in finding qualified employees. That is a real issue. The estimates are that there are about 4 million jobs in the United States today that are begging for qualified employees. And most businesses that I talk to, and I talk to a lot, are telling me that that is their greatest challenge. How to find people with the right skills. And not only they want people to come with the specific technical skills, but they want people who come with what they call, I think it's a wrong word, soft skills. Because yes, you could be very good as a technician, but if you are not a collaborator, if you are not a team, you do not believe in teamwork, if you are not able to be a problem solver, if you're not a critical thinker, you are not of much value to the employers today. So all those, all that information, all that knowledge needs to be part of what we do with the students. At Miami-Dade College, 10 years ago, we joined the Beacon Council. The Beacon Council is a private-public partnership of business and government whose main mission or only mission is to do business development in the area, to support local businesses and to attract businesses from all over the world to Miami. And we decided that we wanted to be part of that because the first thing they did through a lot of research was to identify the 10 industries with the highest growth potential for South Florida. And it was very clear, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10. And what we did was to rearrange, to restructure all of our academic programs, close to 300 different pathways in terms of those 10 clusters of industry. And as a result of that, we made a pledge, a compact with the business community that we would provide the trained workers that they would need where they were industry coming from the outside or existing businesses. So whenever the Beacon Council goes out to Europe or goes out to Latin America or go to Boston or New York or California, the first thing they say is, we have an institution in Miami that will provide whatever training you need. We'll do it efficiently and we'll do it fast. And so again, that's a big challenge and a big burden for us. But I think we have been very successful in doing that. And just to give you a few examples, because I think that's what you asked me and I went on into a tangent, I'm gonna mention a few of the things that we have done in the last couple of years, because they are the most recent. One of the things that was identified through some of the same methods that my colleague here has explained was a tremendous opportunity for the development, strengthening the industry of animation and game development in the South Florida area. A very big industry, a growing industry with a lot of good jobs, high-skilled jobs, but also high-paying jobs. So what we did was we put a team together within the college and some of the business leaders in our community, and we sent them to California to visit some of the major studios, some of the major companies. We spent basically almost a year studying what were the best, what were the latest technology, et cetera, et cetera. And as a result of that, we decided to create a program called Miami Animation and Gaming International Complex, which was modeled, it's modeled after Pixar Studios in California, almost exact copy of the Pixar studio in California. It is an amazing place. I cannot tell you how much attention has gotten since we first opened the doors. We cannot keep up with the demand for the slots to get into the program. And in addition to that, we were able to get Viacom and Nickelodeon, Sony Pictures, Disney, to all collaborate. And the way that they functioned, for example, Pixar not only gave us everything that we needed in order to get this done, but they provide us the licenses for free for most of their software. We got Alienware right now, just before I left, announced that they were donating $100,000 for the next 3 years, and will provide 8 internships, scholarships for students in the program. Every other company is providing mentors. The only downside to that is that they want to get the students even before they finish, because the demand is so much that they just, they did a contest, so two of the students won the contest, and they are taking them to the studios for them to develop their project further with the opportunity to become a TV series. So the students, of course, are benefiting, but we lost two of our best students, but you know, more power to them, because that's what we're there for. So that has been a very important program for us. It's the students, when they complete the program, they get an AES in the computer programming and analysis. They can specialize in either gaming or animation. They get exposed to both, but they need to specialize in one or the other. And they learn a lot of the skills like storytelling and artificial intelligence, character design, and on and on and on and on. These students, when they finish, they can expect to make $75,000 to $80,000 minimum per year. In today's economy, that's a real opportunity. So that's one of the things that we have done. In terms of collaboration, I feel that, again, working with the high schools is crucial, because you want the students to come better prepared when they come exposed to potential careers. So we're working, we do summer camps, for example, in animation. Alienware is paying for the summer camp for the students from high school to come and spend the summer learning animation at the school. So when they finish the high school degree, they come to us with already a basic knowledge of the area. And we also work very closely with a lot of other businesses. The demand for our graduates, not only from the studios, not only from the design houses, but from all kind of businesses that are using animation. We have three major networks located in Miami, TV networks. And we cannot keep up with their demand for these students. So it's an example of how it's happening. It wouldn't happen if it were not because of collaboration with business and industry. And I will repeat it again. I'm not sure 5 years ago, 10 years ago, we could have gotten the collaboration of industry as we are getting it today. Because it's not only saying, yes, we're in, but it's providing resources, it's providing curriculum, it's providing advisors, it's providing mentors, it's providing internships, which is crucial for these students, so when they finish, they're truly prepared.
Thank you so much. I want to move now to questions, and I do have a few prepared, but I'll also look to all of you to get your questions. And actually, Penny, I'd like to go back. We're here at the Philanthropy Roundtable. There are other funders in the room. What would you say was the real epiphany for you all, for the Palmer Foundation, and for starting to look at the work differently than you had in the past?
Well, it's a pathway. I think you have to have the at least the high school, middle school would be great, preparation, which was exactly what you're saying, so that they have the interest in the technology. Now, when I said that we took a PhD professor to be trained in what middle school teachers are doing in the North, he was trying to write a curriculum for high school students so that they would be interested in engineering. He, by the way, this year was elected the top professor in the North Carolina Community College System, which is very nice. Okay, next, learning where foundations fit into this whole picture, I guess. And now I've been with this for both in the North and in the South for quite a while. We can help with equipment. When we toured yesterday Valencia College, and he said this particular piece of equipment was $25,000. There's an opportunity. We have these portable electronics trainers. They had a class of eight, and they only had six trainers. There's an opportunity. I mean, industry, yes, we've been very lucky in industry giving a great deal, and we're only training to what they want. The next thing that they're sort of interested in, which I think is a great idea, is a $35,000 van that they would then put these portable trainers in and take them to on-site training. They could drive it right up to your industry, and then the people come in and have the class, or they could take it from campus to campus. And I think that has some potential and growth potential. I know that Unilever is going to take all of Tuesday with the certified production facility, but maybe they would be able to take that type of thing right to a company's door. We've also found that state policy is a problem. I asked this gal about, well, gee, you're training juniors and seniors. That would be neat if we could be too. Not juniors and seniors, the freshmen and sophomore. In addition, sometimes state policy just limits you. We have a thing called, there's sort of these economic zones, and they don't relate to where our sphere of influence is 60 miles or 75 around the college. Right now, state policy says, unwritten, but it's there, you can only talk to the companies in your county. Well, that's sort of absurd. But so the first year we only hired a 35% ratio. Then when the companies found out that we had these people trained, they drove down, interviewed, et cetera, and within 1 year we were 73% to hire rate. So people, companies who need employees are going to, they don't see state lines, county lines, even country lines. I mean, who are we kidding? So there's some policy work here too that people could do. The other thing that I think that foundations can do is get folks together. We've, in our state, the community foundation community colleges in 2014 had what they called the 1,001 summits. In 100. There are 100 counties, and they asked the three community colleges to get together in a summit and ask their surrounding counties, 10 business people from each county. And that's what they did, and then they started the communication between education and business. The NC Works offices, as part of the unemployment offices, which is pretty negative to begin with. In the NC offices, they will learn about what jobs are available, what skills are needed, and then next to it, what the community college can offer you in skills that will relate to that industry, and how much it'll cost for the certification, and how long it will take, and so forth. And it's bringing people to the college as well for training.
Well, thank you. And I'm thinking about something Dr. Ballinger said on the first panel about just understanding that local economy, and certainly what you're describing is understanding the local economy, understanding the opportunities. Todd, you spoke to this a little bit, but I want to ask more explicitly, how did the use of data and the access to data actually inform a real change in action? What did you witness and see?
Well, I think everybody in terms of the community and such felt in industry, because we do have pretty close relationships directly with industry. So we knew in a lot of cases there were gaps. I think the thing that it's helped the most in terms of the quantify and monetize it is to be able to understand the scale of the gap, and then to start to realize some of the deficiencies in our own ability if we stay with the traditional model of being able to be relevant to the gap. And then how does that, relate to a more systemic understanding of how the different partners need to work together? I think the other piece that we've done, which I didn't cover in my remarks, is we've also developed some models that relate to understanding the marginal value in the economy to taking a high school educated worker working in, again, a high school profile type job, and making them specifically a machinist in our economy, or making them an optical systems tech, or perhaps a hospitality worker. There are differences in terms of what that worker, if they're employed, will cascade in the local economy. And so we've worked with some labor economists to create that. And that's been quite impactful, because I think what it's done is it starts to allow the community generally, the workforce community, and then also even the faculty involved to understand what's at stake and what the importance of their work is. And it allows you also to do some calculations to start to understand, if you're working with a foundation, can we now calculate a general ROI, that if you were to invest in this and we could produce an extra 60 per year of machinist, we now know what the gap would drop by, using the model, and then we know what the marginal value would be to the economy. And so you can start to show really probably, as far as we know, the most accurate way to actually give some sense of what that return on investment would be to institution. Obviously, there's the student return, which is very important in terms of what they're making as well and how they ladder. But I think being able to monetize and quantify this challenge, this complex issue, allows for less convoluted conversations around the table, because now it's not a lot of opinion. It's now, this is what we have. And we're not saying this information is, it's a model, it's approximation, but it's a lot more than what we had before, which is basically anecdata or people's opinion. And we've seen in some cases of doing this where some of that actually isn't a gap, even though people think there is, when you actually go through and that'll actually wash out. So I think that's been some of the biggest things that I've seen. And I think it's been really helpful to get the member education in the legislature to start to understand what's at stake about funding these important areas within our economy in terms of education or not.
Great, thank you. I'm thinking about, President Padron, what you spoke to in terms of the Beacon Council's report on industry sectors and really looking at these 10 industry sectors, and then also Todd's slide from the National Governors Association, which I absolutely want to get a copy of, that really showed it's got to be that full industry collaboration. It's not just about a partnership with one employer to design the program. And so I'll put that forward as one characteristic of effective programs that lead to career pathways, but I'd love to hear from you what you think some of those other characteristics are, the characteristics of the most effective and best programs.
Well, like anything in life, it has to be a win-win situation. It cannot be just expecting favors or that you're going to do this out of charity. Everyone that comes into the room has an interest in getting something out of it, and there is nothing wrong with that. So it's very important that whatever we do, it's to the benefit of different sectors that are participating. That is absolutely key. It's very important to rely on good data, and what you're saying is totally, absolutely correct. The state of Florida, we're fortunate to have very good database for many of the decisions that are made in the state. I'm not saying that they're always used correctly, but at least the data is there. And it is something that helps us, do our job much better. But I think institutions like Miami-Dade and many others, sometimes there is a tendency to become complacent. And we understand that we need to be proactive, that we need to be almost aggressive in pursuing opportunities for students. Our motto is students first, and if we really believe that, that means that our work is not doesn't end with just giving them the knowledge and a diploma, but making sure that they are ready for the next step, and very often that means a job. Many of the students at community colleges continue to senior institutions to complete their degrees, but many of them go directly into jobs. And I think we have an obligation to make sure that we help them get placed on the right jobs so they can, live successful lives. And those students, I think, the idea of stackable credentials is something that has become very fashionable, but it's a very good thing. Because what it does is to provide the students full knowledge of the opportunities they have ahead of them. And they can always come back, and those credentials can always be used to build upon and to really get higher degrees. And we see that happening very often. We have so many students with bachelor's and even master's degrees who come back to the college to get specialized skills in incredible number of areas that some people wouldn't believe that people would come back to do that. But what they're finding is that their ability to get better jobs, to get promotions in their jobs, et cetera, to have a more diversified portfolio, to make themselves more marketable to different companies. We offer the skills that they need. And we have an open door, so exit and entry is very, you don't have to apply as a full-time student and then wait to show your GPA and SAT. That is a real tragedy in America today. We need to liberalize higher education. The system that we had, the best in the world, no doubt, still the best in the world, is a system that worked well for many centuries, but with innovation economy, we need to make sure that we recognize that talent is universal. What's not universal is opportunity. Mm-hmm. And unless we begin to provide people the opportunity to get these credentials, which is essential for the American economy, it's essential for the individuals, we have failed. I always say, and my colleagues get very upset with me when I say this, that for the most part, the only industry that hasn't come into the 21st century is higher education. Mm-hmm. And we need to work at making sure that we do, because education, more than ever in the history of this nation, in the history of the world, is the key determinant between being successful or not. And so community colleges have the real advantage there because we have believed that for the longest time. You have to see at the lines that have traditionally existed and erase them and look for opportunities. We right now are doing a coding course with hundreds and thousands of people. The next cohort, which will begin now in July, already have 500 applicants for that cohort in coding. And guess that we're offering the course, probably is no better course in the world. It's a Harvard course. It was developed by a professor of Harvard. And Jim McElvey, who's a successful entrepreneur, you probably heard of him, came to Miami. We invited him to come. And we said, these are not Harvard students. They look very different. They come from very different backgrounds. They're almost 90% minorities, most of them poor, but they're smart. And I said, and I want to prove it to you. So we started the course in Miami with a successful, incredible passing rate to the point that he said, I'm going to do this permanently. So we're offering that program, which really gives the students a real advantage in looking for jobs. And it's an example of really searching for best opportunities for students. We're working, for example, with McKinsey and their social initiative. It's a 13-week boot camp, which has tremendous opportunity for students. They guarantee interviews at the end. Many of the students are now working for Boeing, for MasterCard, I mean, you name it. We're also working with Amazon in terms of training students to work in the new generation of the cloud system. We're working with Google, the Google Analytics Academy. We're the first college in America to convince Google to do the Google Analytics Academy at the college. Analytics is the way of the future. If you have young people going to college, tell them they better get courses in analytics. There is no question that it is a way of the future. Most businesses could not survive, could not function without knowledge of analytics. And the Google Analytics Academy very much complements our new degree, which is a Bachelor's of Applied Science in Analytics and Big Data, which we have been working on for 2 years with the support of the Business Higher Ed Forum. And it's the only one, the first one in Florida, at that level. And again, there is an incredible demand for that. So these are ways in which we can really collaborate and make sure that we're supplying to the industries the employees that they need, but we're also helping the students have successful mm-hmm. futures.
I'm thinking and even reflecting on the whole day today, and for those who are trying to help seed or start or scale these types of programs in their own communities, I've heard, so stackable credentials are a key characteristic. The employer engagement, we hear over and over. The industry kind of sector, not just individual employers, but looking at industry as a whole, looking at those industry recognized credentials. We heard earlier about contextualized learning and how important building in some of the soft skills and basic skills into the technical skills training can be. And then you also just mentioned the kind of open door or the on and off ramps, as we often talk about, as well as being key to helping students really succeed and be connected to careers. Are there other questions from all of you that you'd like to ask? Joe's running over with the microphone.
I wanted to ask a little bit about the Miami-Dade College. You mentioned the coding course, and I did not, you said you might know the name, and I didn't know the name, so I wonder if you would just tell us something about this person that's teaching the coding course. And then I also wanted to ask regarding coding, and this might be a little inside baseball question that you're not aware of, but there is apparently a move towards, rather than just teaching the language of coding, teaching kind of how coding works and how games are done, et cetera, which is called object-based programming, so they're not having to learn all the coding right up front, so they end up not turned off right up front about it. And I think there's something called Game Salad, which is a platform that lots of people use. I'm just wondering if, I'm sorry, that's all related to the fact that the AP test has also changed, to where instead of just being coding, it's now about much more than that. I'm wondering if what those changes look like, if any, at your college.
Well, yes, as a matter of fact, that's a relatively new territory. But all the students have to have basic knowledge of coding before they're able to do any of the other. And the name of the person is Jim McElvey. And he's a very successful entrepreneur who also was a professor at Harvard. He's no longer teaching the course with us. Now we have other professors teaching it, but it's equally successful. But he supports that because what he does is he has established a network of companies that are in need of the trainees, the students who are we're training. And the beauty of the program is that not only they get the knowledge, but you know, they get opportunities to get employed. You know, most of our students at most of community colleges, I know it's true at Miami-Dade College, go to school, work and go to school. They cannot afford to be full-time students. So, but many of them really are doing jobs that are minimum salary, minimum wage. So while in school, if they're gonna, are able to get skills that will allow them to have better jobs, that's a significant retention factor for the students. It is true, there is a significant you know, retention problem in colleges and universities in the United States. Most of it is because of those reasons, but very often it's because the students do not feel engaged in the learning at the institution. I think that the times when a professor and a piece of chalk and a blackboard would lecture for an hour and the students then leave have to be eliminated. Students have to be engaged in the learning process, have to be interactive. I am a strong believer, and we're totally reforming our learning system at the college on project-based learning. Students engage in projects from beginning to end to be able to apply knowledge. Today, you know, you have knowledge at your fingertips with a computer. So reciting things in history or sociology or in chemistry is not the answer. So I think it's very important to provide the students those opportunities and to get them the opportunity to get that knowledge they have in the classroom and apply it. And project-based learning is giving us significantly greater results in terms of retention, in terms of completion. And we hope that before too late, we're gonna have the entire institution, all disciplines, engaged in the project-based learning. Thank you for the question.
Are there other questions?
Kevin Greer from New Profit. I'm curious, you've each have talked a little bit about working with employers or partnering with employers, and I'm curious if you'd be able to share just any kind of reflections on how you do that effectively, so kind of like effective practices for working with employers. And I'd say a sub-question to that question that's on my mind is just employers aren't like just they aren't like a single entity. They're made up of lots of people, different responsibilities, and it feels like there's different ways that you could engage with them. You could talk kind of focus on the CEO level and building buy-in there, or maybe focusing on frontline hiring managers who are actually making hiring decisions about the skills that are needed, HR departments, et cetera. So could you talk a little bit more about partnering with employers and how you've done that, and even within corporations or companies who you've been working with?
Well, the first thing I'm going, do you want me to answer that?
Well, it's okay.
We'll ask everyone to answer that one.
So. Let me be very brief then.
Okay.
The first thing I want to bring to your attention is that our experience, you talk to the human resource director and you talk to the CEO and you not always get the same answer. I have been very surprised by that, but what the human resource director thinks are the needs and what the CEO thinks are the needs are not necessarily together. So there is a lot of work to be done there. You know, we do very simple things, common sense things that sometimes we don't think about. There is a record of every new business that comes in town that is established, right? So why don't you communicate with each of them and let them know about your services, your ability, and a name of a person that they can contact if that needs for training. We have constant communication with established businesses, large and small, through various organizations. Every program that we offer has an advisory board of about 15 people, and they are representative of business in that specific industry. And those are best sources for training possibilities, not only in their own businesses, but in other businesses that they relate to. So there are many, many ways in which, but you have to be intentional. You cannot expect for people to call you. You have to be intentional about it. And I think once you are intentional, you get very good results.
Did is the Chamber of Commerce called a meeting with the Superintendent of Education, the president of the college, the outreach person of the college, and then businesses in the area. And everybody got a chance to talk. And what was interesting is the companies were so excited that there were the courses at the college that they didn't know were there. Sometimes we think everybody knows what's going on at the community colleges, right? And that the businesses talked about the soft skills as being important. And, you know, today, you know, some of you too are, you know, like this with the, and not talking. And what happens is they don't have people that can answer the phone. They don't have people that can train other people. They don't know how to talk. They don't know how to, you know, so that communication is a huge problem. Well, from that, then they started to have more of an open, you know, they felt they could call the head of the schools or, and the head of the public school system, they asked for internships for ability to have the bright students come in to, and work for an hour or two in a business and get some experience. And in the community colleges, but the other thing is, sometimes it's better to bring the education to the work site. And so there's another organization that we had, CITUS, which is now you're dealing with more computer skills, and they analyze corporate businesses for that are international businesses and their evaluation and so on for large banks actually, and they are located in a very down. Robbins is like, you know, 50% school lunches and all this kind of good community. This guy made his millions in New York and on Wall Street in arbitrage or some such thing. Came back to his hometown and has this financial analysis company there. Sandhills trains their workers, which are now at 250 workers, and they're going to 300. And they do analysis from all over the world. They've actually tweaked it to exactly what they wanted. And Sandhills professors come, and they have a room, and they train the people how to do the technology. We've tweaked our curriculum at the community college. In nursing, this year they dropped nurse aides. There isn't as much of a call for that. You think about the reality of the medical field now. Basically, we're going to nurse practitioners. So they want this. You can be hired as a practical nurse, but within 2 years they want you to have the RN, and then they hope that maybe quite a few of those will go on to be a nurse practitioner. I'm trying to think of some other areas. It's guessing. Yeah.
and Todd, what about you? Do you have things to add on effective employer engagement?
So we similarly, we use a proactive strategy. We're pretty strategic about it. So we've adopted a business-to-business model. So we use a customer relationship methodology. We use Salesforce.com. And we basically have an opt-in database that we developed. We have asked businesses to opt in to receive information from the college for purposes of either just being kept informed of training, you know, opportunities, grants, opportunities, advisory board service for their employees, HR directors like that. It's a way for them to let their employees give back, but it's also a way for them to be seen as giving back as an organization to the community. And then we also have dedicated staff that go out, and their only job is to day-to-day go out and make cold calls to businesses. And that's tracked in the system, and then we're using that more and more to also track opportunities for internships. So we want the business community to see the community college, at least MCC in this situation, as a robust kind of multi-layered source, not just of education and training, that's obviously what they think about us. We want to educate them, and I use that in a very non-pejorative way, to think about us for many other things. And so we try to do that again through this platform of Salesforce. And just throw out, if you don't have a platform like that, Salesforce.com has a foundation, and generally a nonprofit or an educational institution can get a 10 enterprise user license for free if you apply through to that. And it's a very robust platform. It's the number one, and so there's a lot of integration points to it, just for what it's worth. That's.
I'm thinking about one of the slides that Penny showed that so ran through the list of employers who had contributed to buy equipment or had contributed equipment, and then you had a later slide that showed where students got hired. And I just wonder if you both see that as well, that the employers who are engaged in the design and sort of evolution of the programs that you're offering are also the ones who are then anxious and ready to hire your completers. Todd, or?
Well, in our case, and it's probably the case of many community colleges, it's a SUNY institution, all of our technical programs have to have advisory boards that consist of employers that hire, and when there's actually a performance-based funding that we get for doing that. But we do it anyway. I mean, the reality is absolutely the employers, particularly in advanced manufacturing and healthcare areas, are fairly desperate for those students. They need the workers. And so they're very interested and motivated to hire them, and they certainly advise us on the curricula they want taught to give the students the skill sets they want in their workplace.